السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فقد قال الله تبارك وتعالى في قرآنه العزيز بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، ولنبلونكم بشيء من الخوف والجوع ونقص من الأموال والأنفس والثمرات وبشر الصابرين الذين إذا أصابتهم مصيبة قالوا إنا لله وإنا إليه راجعون أولئك عليهم صلوات من ربهم ورحمة وأولئك هم المهتدون. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, today if you were to look at the Muslim Ummah at large, the Muslim Ummah at large is facing great trials, tribulations and calamities. Likewise, if we were to scale it down and look at our own personal life, we too are going through trials, problems, afflictions and calamities. This, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is because Allah the Almighty, He created life in such a manner that He divided it into parts. He divided it into parts, and we focus out of these parts this life, the life of dunya and the life of akhirah. Because of course Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created life where we were in the alamul arwah, and then there is also something known as barzakh. But we'll be talking about the life of this dunya in comparison to the life of akhirah. First and foremost, what we need to internalize is that in regard to the life of this dunya, it is temporary, it is transitory. It is a stage that we are crossing through. So this life, it is not a life that is supposed to be loved, nor is it a life to be lived, but rather it is a life to get over with. It is not something that we are supposed to latch our hearts onto, to cling to. Because it is temporary, it is just a matter of 60 to 70 years which we pass through, and our destination is Al-Akhirah, which is eternal and permanent. That is our eternal resting abode. So if we were to take this dunya, the life of this dunya, the pleasures of this world are short. The pleasures of this world are short-lived, likewise the problems of this world are short-lived. The calamities of this world are short-lived. The thing which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Noble Quran in regard to these trials and calamities is that the believers, they will bear patience when they come across trials and afflictions. Because it is a sign of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's love that He afflicts a believer with a particular trial or a calamity. If we were to take the life of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the most beloved unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, look at the amount of trials and calamities he went through. He being the most beloved unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala could have kept him like a king with no problem at all in this world. But no, on the other hand we see that our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he came to this world as an orphan. He lost his father even before his birth. And after coming to this world, within a matter of about 6 years, he loses his beloved mother. And then he goes under the care of his grandfather Abdul Muttalib. And that too, after a few years, he loses his grandfather also. And then he goes under the care of his uncle Abu Talib. And then after some time, he loses his uncle Abu Talib. He loses his beloved wife Khadija radiallahu anha. And he goes through so much of trials and persecution whilst he brought the message of goodness, the message of guidance, hidayah. But the kuffar, his own tribesmen, they put him out of his hometown. They put him out of Makkah. They persecuted him. They boycotted Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Muslims. And if we were to even go further, Allahu Akbar, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was blessed with 7 children. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was blessed with 7 children, and he lost all 7 of his children whilst he was alive, except for Fatima radiallahu anha. 7 children, 3 sons, Al-Qasim, Abdullah, and Ibrahim. And as for his daughters, Zainab, Ruqayya, Umm Kulthum, and Fatima radiallahu anhum ajma'in. He lost all of them except for Fatima radiallahu anha, who lived after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam for a few years. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, if we were to take the instance of the death of one of his sons, Ibrahim, Allahu Akbar. The narration goes to the effect that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he comes to where his son, in one of his wife's houses, he comes to where Ibrahim, his beloved son, just a little more than a year. Now each one of us, we need to picture this. Our children are so beloved to us, and that too when they are small. We come home after so much of, you know, perhaps stress that we face at work, so much of tension, but the minute we see our child, all of that vanishes away. The minute we see him trying to formulate words in his small age, that melts our heart. Our children are the apples of our eyes, the coolness to our heart. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enters the room where his son is, and he sees his beloved son gasping, Allahu Akbar. He sees him gasping. We see, even if we were to see an elderly person in the throes of death gasping, we can't bear it. But how would it be to see a child just a little over a year of age, him gasping, convulsing and gasping? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sees the sight and starts tearing, Allahu Akbar. He starts tearing because he could not bear it. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf radiallahu anhu was next to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He asked, Ya Rasulullah, what is this? Are you crying? He asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, Ya Ibn Auf, Innaha rahma. It is mercy that is bringing these tears to my eyes. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he goes on to say, Inna la'ayna tazma' wal qalba yahzan wa la naqulu illa ma yarda rabbuna. Allahu Akbar. Our hearts are heavy, tears are flowing, but nothing that would anger our Lord is going to come from our tongues. Allahu Akbar. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam goes on to say, Wa inna bi firafika ya Ibrahim la mahzunun. And O Ibrahim, this separation is indeed grieving us. But then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he does not have life and death in his hands. It is the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam accepts the decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam buried all of his children with his own hands. Just imagine, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, 6 children, to lose 6 children after consecutively losing beloved ones in his family. Look at the amount of trials Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went through. The reason being, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, there are so many ahadith along the lines of these words, that if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves a nation, indeed Allah the Almighty will test that nation. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves an individual, Allah will indeed test that individual. And in another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said that an individual is tested according to the levels of his iman. For if the levels of his iman are high, then the affliction, the trial that is going to come is also going to be tailor-made for his iman. And remember that these trials, these afflictions, these calamities are blessings in disguise. They are all blessings in disguise. But sadly, at times, due to the weakness of our iman, we question our powerful maker. We question him saying that, why am I being afflicted as such? But remember, all of these trials, they polish us to the better. They keep increasing us in rank. For each trial, our sins are forgiven. Rewards are being written, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. For each and every trial, in another narration, the words go along the lines of these words, that even for a thorn, even for a tiny thorn pricking a believer, his sins are forgiven. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. And then the ayah that I recited in the beginning, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ وَنَقْصٍ مِّنَ الْأَمْوَالِ وَالْأَنفُسِ وَالثَّمَرَاتِ, that indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that we will test your بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ, with something related to fear, والجوع, hunger, perhaps financial losses, etc. And then the loss of lives, the loss of beloved ones, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, the loss of wealth. And finally Allah says, وَبَشِّرِ الصَّابِرِينَ, but give glad tidings to the ones who hold on patiently. Give glad tidings to the ones who are patient. أَلَّذِينَ إِذَا أَصَابَتْهُمْ مُسِيبًا, those, the ones who are, when they are afflicted by a calamity and affliction, قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, they don't say anything that would anger their maker, but rather they say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajiun. Indeed, we belong to Allah and to Him we return.
Ulaika alayhim salawatum min rabbihim wa rahman wa ulaika humul muhtadun.
They are those salawatum min rabbihim wa rahma, blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, wa rahma, and mercy will be upon them. Wa ulaika humul muhtadun, and indeed they are the ones who are guided on the straight path. I've got a few more minutes and I wish to share a story. The story I got it from, the source I got it from, they told me that it's a true story. But I think the story must have done its rounds on social media and perhaps you would have already heard it. But there are so many lessons to be derived from this story, so I thought it worthwhile mentioning. The story of a rich young girl whose name was Anfal. She was a rich young girl, a Muslim girl, was holding a high post in a particular company, getting a good salary, but she wasn't religious. Rather, she was not religious at all. She was just a Muslim by name. So that one day she was about to go for a party. She had an appointment with the hairdressers to go and dress herself up and then head for the party. But just before that, her family wanted her to go to the doctors and get herself checked up, because there was an odd ache in one of her limbs, which was something sudden, and due to her being young of age, they wanted her to go check it up. So she goes to the doctor. Now she had already submitted the reports and she's just going in for the checkup. So she waits for her turn at the clinic, and then when the doctor calls, when the nurse calls for her, she goes in. When she goes in, she sees the doctor looking very sad and serious. So this worried her a bit, and then she sits by the doctor, and then the doctor says, is this report yours? So she lies, because she wants to know the truth, and she was fearing that if she says that yes, it is mine, he might hide something from her. So she says, no, it's my daughter's. Then the doctor asks her, so why have you come alone then? Why didn't you bring your husband? Then she goes on to say, she gives an excuse. Then finally the doctor says, well, this is something, when I see you, I look at you, you are educated, and I think you will understand the gravity of the situation. This is about life and death we are talking here. There is an odd disease which has afflicted the blood of this particular patient, and it seems to be something similar to cancer. Now this girl, she looks down. She looks dejected, she looks down, because it's her report. She starts tearing, and then she says, I'm finished. Then the doctor understands that she lied, that this is her report. Then he asks her, why did you lie? Why did you lie, my dear daughter? Then she says, no, I wanted to know the truth. Then he says, I'm sorry, but the truth is bitter. There is no hope for you unless and of course if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wins. This is a terminal disease. This is a terminal disease that has afflicted you. Now she's so upset. She takes the report. She heads back home. There is no hope for her. She goes back home. She enters her home. Her parents, all of them are getting ready for the party. They ask her, so did you go to the doctor and how come you're not going to the hairdressers? What happened? She rushes to her room and just closes the door and falls on the bed. She says, no, nothing. She screams back, nothing. I didn't get to go to the doctor, but I'm not feeling well. I can't make it to the party. She goes and falls on the bed. She starts weeping. She starts crying. She looks around at her room. She looks at the curtains that she put. She looks at all her branded items that she bought. She looks at her Louis Vuitton shoes. She looks at her Charles and Keith bags that she has bought, all of her branded items. And then she remembers the advice of her friend who kept on reminding her of the ayah where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَتَزَوَّذُوا فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. وَتَزَوَّذُوا, take provision. فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. For indeed the best of provisions is taqwa. وَاتَّقُونِ يَا أُولِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and fear me, O people of intellect. She remembers all of these ayats. She's regretting, so many years of my life went past. Now my deadline is in front of me. What have I done? Am I prepared to meet my powerful maker? What have I done? How can I stand in front of him? She looks around, she hears the voices of her family. She's crying, weeping, she does not know what to do. Then she remembers the ayah that her grandfather used to always recite. قُلْ يَتَوَفَّاكُمْ مَلَكُ الْمَوْتِ الَّذِي وُكِّلَ بِكُمْ ثُمَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكُمْ تُرْجَعُونَ وَلَوْ تَرَىٰ إِذِ الْمُجْرِمُونَ نَاكِسُوا رُؤُوسِهِمْ عِندَ رَبِّهِمْ رَبَّنَا أَبْصَرْنَا وَسَمِعْنَا فَارْجِعْنَا نَعْمَلْ صَالِحًا إِنَّا مُوقِنُونَ. When the angel of death comes to do what he has been entrusted to do, at that time those criminals, وَلَوْ تَرَىٰ إِذِ الْمُجْرِمُونَ نَاكِسُوا رُؤُوسِهِمْ, they'll be hanging their heads. And they'll say, رَبَّنَا أَبْصَرْنَا وَسَمِعْنَا فَرْجِعْنَا. Oh Allah, now we have seen everything. Everything is in front of us. We have heard. Please send us back so that we may do good deeds. But that will never happen. That will never happen. For when the angel of death comes, not a second even will be given for these individuals, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. She remembers these ayats. She starts weeping. She does not know what to do. She keeps crying. She's so upset, she looks around. These are her last few days. What are the good deeds that she has to do? At least to meet her maker. Then suddenly the phone rings. The phone rings. She goes to the telephone. She answers it. Somebody says, is this Miss Anfar? She says, yes, it's me speaking. And she recognizes the doctor's voice. She recognizes the doctor's voice. She immediately asks him, doctor, is there any hope for me if I go abroad? Can I cure myself? The doctor says, my dear daughter, there has been a mistake. Now she's even worried. She's even worried. Her heart is as if a fist is clutching at her heart. There has been a mistake. There was a mix-up with the reports, and I have accidentally read out the report of somebody else. Alhamdulillah, you are fine. You are not afflicted by any leukemia or blood disease or anything of that sort. You're perfectly healthy. Allahu Akbar. She cries out, Alhamdulillah. She keeps the phone back. She thanks the doctor. She keeps the phone. And it is as if she was born on that day. It was as if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave her a new chance. She starts off. She repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She writes down these verses that she remembered. And she also writes down a saying going as, repent just the day before you die. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala just the day before you die. Do any one of us know when we will die? So if we follow that, we will always be repenting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because none of us can guarantee that we would even leave the doors of this masjid. So my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before it is too late. And likewise, in regard to the calamities, trials, afflictions that all of us are going through, hold on patiently, because these are signs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is polishing you to the better. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants the best for all of you. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam,
pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He forgives all of our sins, and may He accept all of our good deeds, and may He unite us all in the gardens of Jannah.